Now I request Professor K.S. Kannan to deliver the valedictory address. Professor K.S. Kannan is presently holding a chair in IIT Madras for Sanskrit studies and Indological studies. He was a professor at Jain University in Bangalore. He has authored several books ranging from shastras like Vyakarana and Nyaya, practical shastras like Ayurveda, and two Indological works like critical editions and historical works and studies on Vakyapadiyam, studies on all branches of Indian shastras and philosophy. I request Professor K.S. Kannan, who has been a fighter by nature in behalf of Hindu knowledge systems. He fights the distortions of Hindu knowledge systems ferociously. Today, he is going to speak on Hindu metaphysical foundations of what is generally labeled as Indian aesthetics. Professor Kannan.
Jnanandamayam Devam Nirmalasphatikakritim आधारं सर्वविद्यानां हयग्रीवम् उपास्महे. I am extremely thankful to Professor Paturi for inviting me to participate in this conference, and especially giving me valedictory address. Though giving a valedictory address at a post lunch session can be somewhat uninspiring, as the sessions just before lunch and just after lunch can be somewhat difficult to handle and manage. Still, I take this opportunity to give expression to some of the thoughts on this topic of Hindu metaphysical foundations of Indian aesthetics. I had entitled the paper as Metaphysical Foundations of Aesthetics, and Professor Paturi improved it. Improve upon it by making it Hindu metaphysical foundations of aesthetics. In fact, bringing out the very idea that I had in my mind, I was definitely going to speak about the Hindu metaphysical foundations, and as though knowing what was in my mind, I must say that Dr. Ullamani and Professor Paturi are bringing about a veritable renaissance of our heritage.
Maybe you can keep it a little far from your mouth. It is now, there is an echo there.
Yeah. I don't have a person to assist me technically, that's why I'm facing some problems. Okay. This conference has been excellent in the sense that some of the greatest luminaries have given their addresses. Dr. Padma Subramaniam, Shatavadani, Dr. Ganesh, and Vinod Vidvans, among others. And I was also very happy to see many youngsters taking part in a very spirited manner. The first thing that I must say is that this conference is very much called for, especially against the background of the kind of abuses that our heritage has been subject to, especially at the hands of the wicked foreigners. I'll give you only one of the samples. This is what Mr. Max Muller said. The idea of the beautiful in nature did not exist in the Hindu mind. They never excelled either in sculpture or painting. They did not mind giving a god ever so many arms to indicate his omnipotence. Vincent Smith, he says, Indian sculpture, properly so called, hardly deserves to be reckoned as art. The figures of both men and animals become stiff and formal, and the idea of power is clumsily expressed by the multiplication of members, the many-headed, many-armed gods and goddesses whose images crowd the walls and roofs of medieval temples have no pretensions to beauty and are frequently hideous and grotesque. Sir George Birdwood, he says, the monstrous shapes of the Puranic deities are unsuitable for the higher forms of artistic representation. And this is possibly why sculpture and painting are unknown as fine arts in India.
Professor, so originally, wherever you kept the mic in the beginning, that was the perfect place, yeah. Except bending. Everything was all right. That original position. Wherever you kept the mic in the beginning, that was perfect.
Okay. Is it better now?
Yeah, it is better.
Okay. Professor Pathri himself spoke of the recent Westerner, who said Indians have not had any kind of theory that can relate the various fields of art. And he also spoke of how, for example, in the last talk that was given, for a typical Westerner, this would appear like mere noise and something that had no element of music. Now, we have to combat a situation that has developed on account of such legacies of Western criticisms which drown Indian voices, primarily because they bring out excellent publications, conduct conferences and seminars, and have excellent libraries and journals, and with this massive infrastructure, they fight our heritage, and Indians are dumbfounded not to know what to do. And it is conferences like this that can really help. We can see that the great regard for art and for our great values that go along with them, and the values adorned in our various types of art, they start right from the Vedas. And I'll give you one or two samples of how there is poetic beauty in the Vedas. The Veda itself speaks of the words Kavi and Kavya. So the words Kavi and Kavya inherit right from the Vedic literature. The Veda itself says, Devasya Pashya Kavyam Namamarana Viryati. So look at the Kavya of the divinity, so which neither dies nor gets old. This concept of something being ajara and amara, so never getting old and never dying, obtains in the Vedas itself. So in the Vedas themselves, and there is a reference to the Kavya being such. Again, you can find very many ideas of poetry, such as the various Shabdalankaras and Arthalankaras in the Vedas. Take, for example, the typical Yamaka type of composition in the Taittiriya Upanishad text, Aham Vrikshasya Reriva, Kirti Krishnam Gireriva. So, there you can see that the expression Reriva, Reriva, you see, repeating there, so contributing to the Yamaka concept. There are beautiful expressions of the enjoyment of beauty. Right in the morning, we contemplate upon the splendor of Surya. Tatsavituru varenyam bhagyaha devasya dhimahi. So his little shining and his splendorous orb we look upon. There is the beautiful adoration of Vishas in the Vishas Sukta Punaspunar Jayamana Purani. Excellent metaphors that you obtain in Dvansuparna Sahija Kathaya, or Chatvari Sanga Trayovasya Padaha, or even in Urdhamulu Avatshasaha. So it can all be given as examples for various alankaras. And the kind of paradoxes that you find in some of the verses that were already cited. So for example, Urdhamulu Avatshasaha, and even Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Avashishyate. Bring out the paradoxes that are present in poetry, typically present in poetry. We adore Saraswati Devi, the expression Chodayitri Sundrutana Chetanti Samatina. It is she who inspires excellent, sweet but free words. Sundrutana stands for that. And Chetanti Samatina, it is not merely pleasing to the ears, but it is also something that enlivens our intellect. And what the Vedic literature says is also something that the text itself can also recall. The quote is Gopika Gita, which says, Madhuraya Gira Valgu Vasyaya Buddha Madhya Pushparekshana. So, Madhuraya Gira, the sweet words, Valgu Vasyaya. So, it's a very enjoyable utterances, and at the same time, they are Buddha Manodnaya. They are something that are adored by the scholarly. So, the Sundrutanam, Chodayitri, and Samatinam, Chetanti, the two aspects coming together in the adoration of Saraswati are present equally well in what may be called the folk songs of the Gopikas. The presence of the concepts of Satyam, Shivam, and Sundaram have been all in a single sutra have been brought out by Dr. Vishal Agarwal, and it can be traced in all of the BVP lists. There is also the concept of Yanjana in the Vedic utterances, where what is seen is very trivial and what is not seen is extraordinary. Of course, even regarding speech, it is said, Chatvari va parimita padani, tani yudur brahmana ye manishanaha, guhatyami nehita nengayanti, tadiyam vachaha manishya vadanti. What is speak is after all but a quarter of the whole. This is comparable to the creation of the world itself, where you say, padosya vishwa bhutani tripadasya amritam divi, is only a small thing as the visible world, but it is much beyond. So, and therefore, what is beyond, what is unseen, is much superior to, much larger than, and very greater in value than what is seen. And there is also the mystery of something that is present everywhere, but not seen everywhere. Yesha sarvesu bhutesu gudhotma na prakashate. And already in the Vedas, I gave one example for the paradox. There is another famous example, Udatva Pashyan Radarshavacham Udatva Pashyan Nashanoti Chanyaha. In the Vedas themselves, we have the reference to the Shilpa. Divridvai Shilpam says Shankhayana Brahmana, and it says Nrityam Gitam Vaditramiti. So it refers to all the theory. So in fact, we can know that in Sangeeta Ratnakara, the definition of Sangeeta given is Gitam Vadyanch Nrityam Chatrayam Sangeetam Ichyate, and this combination of the vital three is present already in the Vedic literature. And in the Aitareya Brahmana, we have the reference to the Shilpa being Atma Samskriti. Atma Samskriti Rivai Shilpani. And it also shows how, for example, our own instrument, the Veena, is modeled after a divine Veena. So, even Devi Veena. So, the only precursor of Manushi Veena Bhavati. And therefore, we have divine images of, divine originals of the things that we have before us as a most famous musical instrument. And it can be seen that even the Merudanda, our spinal cord itself is shaped like a Veena, after which the Manushi Veena or the human Veena that we prepare is modeled. And therefore, the divine archetype is also something, not something to be come across only in some stories and mythological representations. It is right there, so in our very, very physique. So this way,
the reference to the poetry and to the various
types of art. So all these come under one heading called Shilpa. That is Gita, Vadya, Nritya. So all these come under the type Shilpa. And we must also note that
the
metaphysical foundation of all these is in
even in the derivation of the world.
The word Shilpa itself is derived from Shira Samadhi. And therefore, all these perceive the very depths of the human experience and the very, very peak of human experience. If you look into the Ramayana, for example, we see that Ayodhya, it is said, was crowded with the various types of artisans. Ushitam Sarva Shilpajihi, says the Ramayana. The palace of Ravana itself, who was modeled like a Vimana, says the Ramayana. And as to the musical qualities present in the Ramayana, we see that it was Pache Gaye Chamadhuram. So it is very pleasant to read and very melodious for singing. It can be set to music so very naturally. So the two boys, the twins, Lava and Kisha, Kavyaneta, Agayatam, Agayatam, Marga Vidhana Sampada. So already the types of Marga and Deshi are very clearly known. And that is how they sang the Ramayana.
And coming to
Mahabharata, the very work Bhagavad Gita, it occupies the very heart of the Mahabharata and is a miracle reflection of the entire theme of Mahabharata. Itself is entitled Gita.
It means it is something that is sung. And in the Bhagavata,
we have the descriptions of something that is extremely charming and beautiful. It says, Tadeva Ramyam, Ruchiram, Navam, Navam, Tadeva Shashyam, Maso, Mahotsavam, Tadeva Shokarnam, Choshanam, Ram, Yuttam, Shloka, Ishamana, Giyate. The very theme of our Mahakavyas is Uttam Shloka Varna. So Uttam Shloka Isho Nagiyate. So and they are the ones that are Shokarnamaya Shosha. You must contrast such words with modern productions which nowhere stand in comparison to the extraordinary productions, because Tadeva Ramyam Ruchiram Navam Navam. So ever so many times we read those works like the Ramayana and the Mahabharata and the Bhagavata, they never grow stale. Tadeva Shastram Haso Mahotsavam. The previous talk was regarding an Utsava, and it is spoken of how Utsavas are an integral part of our heritage, and every Utsava, the completion of every Utsava is with an Avabhrita Snana, and that is therefore described as an equivalent to the performance of Yajna. One may note etymologically that the word Utsava itself is from the word Sava. Utsute Harsham iti Utsavaha is one derivation, and the word Sava itself stands for Sava, or Savana stands for Yajna. And we can see that in Bharata's Natyashastra, so a very high place
is given to this field of the performance of
the art of the stage, and it is given a very high place on a very high pedestal, and it is called Natya Veda. So the Natya Veda is drawn from all the four Vedas. Jagraha Pathyam, Rigveda, Samabhyo, Gitamevacha, Yajurveda, Daghanayam, Prasana, Atharvanagati. So it is composed of material from all the four Vedas. And just we find that it is a sort of a Chaitanya tradition right from the Vedas. And regarding this
Kalidasa says, Devanam idam amananti munayaha kantam kratum chakshusham rudrene idam umakratavyatikare swange vibhaktam dvidha. As Lasya and Tandava, it is divided into two in the very person of Lord Shiva. Trailokyodho matra lokacharitam nanarasam drishyate natyam bhinna ruche janasya bodha pyekam samaradhanam. So the త్రైగుణ్యోద్భవమత్ర లోకచరితం నానారసం దృశ్యతే ది వేస్ ఆఫ్ ది వరల్డ్ ఆల్ ఇష్యూయింగ్ ఫ్రమ్ ది ఇంటర్ప్లే ఆఫ్ ది త్రిగుణాస్ ఈ సీన్ హియర్ వెరీ వివిడ్లీ అండ్ దేర్ ఫోర్ దిస్ ఈస్ సంథింగ్ విచ్ ఈస్ ఇండీడ్ వెరీ వెరీ డివైన్ అండ్ అట్ ది సేమ్ టైమ్ ఇట్ సాటిస్ఫైస్ పీపుల్ ఆఫ్ వెరీ టైమ్స్ అండ్ భరతాస్ నాట్యశాస్త్ర ఇట్ సెల్ఫ్ క్లెయిమ్డ్ శ్రుతి స్మృతి సదాచార పరిశేషార్థ కల్పనం వినోద జననం లోకే నాట్యమేతద్ భవిష్యతి నాట్యాఖ్యం పంచమం వేదం సేతిహాసం కరోమ్యహం సో ఇట్ ఈస్ బీన్ షోన్ యాజ్ ది ఫిఫ్త్ వేద ఇట్స్ నాట్ ఎ క్వశ్చన్ ఆఫ్ సంథింగ్ బీయింగ్ ఎలివేటెడ్ టు దట్ స్టేజ్ ఆఫ్ బీయింగ్ ఎ ఫిఫ్త్ వేద బట్ ఆన్ ది అదర్ హ్యాండ్ ఇట్ హ్యాస్ ఇట్ క్యాన్ ఇట్ ఇట్ ఈస్ సంథింగ్ దట్ క్యాన్ స్టాండ్ ఆర్ సిట్ ఆన్ పార్ విత్ ది అదర్ వేదాస్ ఇన్ ఫ్యాక్ట్ there is a statement of Dharmasuri so who says that even in the Vedas we have all poetic features so in his work called Sahitya Ratnakara Dharmasuri is a poet of the alankarika of the 16th century so he says santyevahi prayasho vedeshvapi kavya lakshana lakshitani adoshani sagunani salankarani vakyani so thus we find that the Veda itself is poetic and at the same time some of the best traditions of art are derived from the Vedas we can see that it is exactly after the model of the words of Arjuna in the Bhagavad Gita towards Krishna saying pitev putrasya sakheva sakhyuh priyah priyayar hasi deva sodhum so we have three models there pitev putrasya and sakheva sakhyuh and priyah priyayah so these exactly correspond to what can be what have been labeled as prabhu samhita mitra samhita and kanta samhita the purpose of all the three samhitas is the same so their modes vary and piteva putrasya so the father's command is as of a king as of the lord of the house and sakheva sakhyuh as a friend so do the puranas function and priyah priyayah so it is like a lover so that we have the kanta samhita and all these three thus have a single purpose of communicating to man so not merely some piece of entertainment but something that educates him and elevates him and ennobles him the very significance of the word kavi is significant is to be noticed so in the Vedic literature itself we have Kavim Puranam Anushasitaram applied to the Lord himself and in the Bhagavata we have the reference to Brahma as the Kavi and Valmiki is known as the Adi Kavi and in the Mahanarayana we have Yamantas Samudre Kavayo Vayanti all showing the exalted stature of the Kavi but even more explicitly we have the statement of Bhattatauta so where he shows that it is only a rishi who can write a kavya so it's only a person who is like a rishi that can write a true kavya and it's not a kavya that anyone labels what his own writing is and therefore the even in the opening session it was pointed out how a rishi becomes a kavi and a kavi is indeed a rishi so this two way equation of the rishi and the kavi being on par is one of the important aspects of our aesthetics Bhattadutta says nadevamsho dadatyannam narudrah krama pathakah nanrishah kurute kavyam na vishnu prithivipatih and right in the nirukta we have the expression rishir darshanat so it's only because of his extraordinary darshana so we also have the statement kavihi krantadarshi so one who sees much beyond what ordinary people can do and the memorable works of Bhattadauta nandrishik kaviryuktam rishishchakila darshanat vichitra bhava dharmamsha tattva prakhyacha darshanam it's a beautiful verse which gives the definition of kavi so in terms of rishi and the next line gives the definition of rishi and the next line gives a definition of the darshana that the rishi should have vichitra bhava dharmamsha tattva prakhyacha darshanam it's only a tattvajnanin who can become a rishi so this tradition was honored even by Jain alankarikas For example, Hemachandra says, sa tattva darshanadeva shastreshu patitah kavih darshanad varnanachatha jata loke kavishrutih. So the title kavi kavishrutih, so it is only because of these two aspects, namely darshana and varnana. This burden of darshana and varnana, to be able to see things and to be able to articulate the same, so is something that is common to all branches of Indian aesthetics. And Ananda Kumar Swami shows how every darshana involves what is called a contemplation. In fact, Kumar Swami has dwelt on this theme of art as yoga. So in when the poet he contemplates on what he writes, it is a virtual contemplation. And when the artist tries to imagine what he was going to write, that is also a contemplation. In fact, contemplative procedures are prescribed for example, in the design of sculptures and so on. And as in the case of attaining Brahmajnana, so in the practice of yoga, poeticians like Rajashekhara have prescribed the Brahma Muhurta as the right time for creating even poetry. And therefore, we find that there is an intimate relationship between Kavitva and Yogitva. And there is one beautiful verse as the concluding verse of Jivan Muktanand Lahari, which gives a definition of Kavi. It says, Imam Muktavastham Paramashiva Samstham Guru Kripa Kripa Panga Vyapyam Paramasukha Vapyam Anudinam Muhur Majjan Majjan Bhajati Sukritaishchen Naravaraha Sada Tyagi Yogi Kaviriti Vadanti He Kavayaha. So it's only a Kavi who can define who a true Kavi is. And Shankara, the great, the giant of a scholar and an intellectual, was also a great poet. And his definition of a true poet is something that shows what the true poet should be. So Imam Mukta Avastham, he is a veritable Jivan Mukta. Paramashiva Samstham, Guru Kripa, Sudha Panga Vyapyam, Paramasukha Vapyam, Anudinam Muhur Majjan Majjan. So he drowns himself every day in the state of deep meditation, the yogic state, and it's only such a person who has seen the very depths of life that can become a true poet. So that is the kind of high status that is awarded to the great poet. And we can see that Kalidasa himself was a great Sankhya yogin. So we can see, for example, in the very opening verse of his Abhijnana Shakuntala, he goes to the very origin of the universe. Ya srishti srashturadhyā vahati vidhutam ya havir yacha hotri ye dve kalam vidhatta shruti vishaya guna yasthita vyapya vishvam ya mahu sarva bija prakritiriti yaya pranina pranamanta pratyakshabhya prapannastanabhiravata vastabhirashta abhirishaha. So he goes to the very origin of the universe, and he also shows how the entire universe in the Ashtamurti aspect of Lord Shiva. And while Kavi and Kavya engage themselves in the description of the world, the conclusion of their work is also in the various conclusion of the Shakuntala, Punarbhavam Parigata Shakti Ratma Bhuhu. So may I transcend this cycle of births and deaths. So this aspect of describing the entire creation and ultimately concluding with the transcendence of creation is what is beautifully brought out in the Kalidasa, typified by Kalidasa's Shakuntala, and shows the span of poetic achievement. And as Ananda Kumar Swami has very beautifully shown, the alankaras in poetry are not merely external and extraneous ornaments that can be had and removed. In fact, he traces the word alankarana to the Vedic arankarana. So it is something that enables something. So strengthening something, instilling life in something, and so on. So thus, alankaras are something that enhance the value of the content and make it more agreeable and more potent. And even so, the word abharana. So Kumar Swami has written an article on abharana also. And we can see the spiritual depths of the very vocabulary of these words and the semantic dimensions by going to such sources that we can realize the significance of these. And when it comes to the representation of our own gods and goddesses, we can see that they are all shown as Kalava Labhas. So there is no god perhaps that is not devoted to some Kala. So in Sangeet Ratnakara, we get a reference to the various divinities who are attached to the various types of arts. For example, it says, Gitena Priyate Devaha Sarvajnaha Parvati Patihi Gopi Patir Anantopi Omshadhani Vashangataha Samagiti Rato Brahma Veena Sakta Saraswati. So Saraswati plays on the Veena, and Brahma is an expert in Samagana, and Lord Krishna so plays on the flute, and then Parvati Pati is pleased by the Gita, and so on. But much more than this, we can see the origin of the various kalas, so issuing from, you see, the Lord himself. So just to draw an attention to the various types of arts which are all connected with the gods, I must give you some quotations. So in the Kalachuri inscription, the Lord is described as Trailokya Saudha Shilpi. So the Bhagavan is a Shilpi. And in Abhinava Gupta's expression, we have the Lord described as Trailokya Sthapatihi Tvameva Bhagavan Vishwakritir Jrimbhasi. So you are the Sthapati of the entire creation. And in another work, which we refer to Nigamakave Stava Nataka Prabandhaha. So the poet says that the whole world is a nataka, and this is authored by Nigamakavi, the author who is a himself a poet who has written the Vedas. So who is the author of the Vedas? And there is also a reference to the Lord himself as being the sutradhara of the entire world. Nilagriva tamasi bhuvana sthapana sutradharaha. You are the sutradhara. And it's not merely Lord Shiva who is spoken of as the sutradhara. Bhasa in his Dutavakya refers to the Lord as Sutradhara. He says, Narayana Stribhuvanaika Parayano Vaha Payad Apayashata Yuktikaraha Suranam Lokatraya Virata Nataka Tantra Vastu Prastavana Pritisamapana Sutradharaha. The Lord himself is engaged in this Nataka of the three worlds, Lokatraya. And this is a continuous drama that is happening. It's not something, there's a one-act play or a play with numerous scenes and so on. It's a continuous drama that is going on. Avirata Nataka. Lokatraya Avirata Nataka. And he is himself the technique. So he is the Lord is the constitutes the technique of the plays. So this play, Tantra. And he is the theme, Vastu. And he is the prologue of the play, Prastavana. And he is also the denouement of the play, Pratisamapana, Sutradhara, and he is the person who holds the strings of the entire play. So, Natyopa Karanadini Sutramityabhidhiyate, Sutram Dharayati Ityarthe, Sutradharo Abhidhiyate. So, the Lord is himself, in fact, there is a sort of an Advaitic vision here of the Lord himself being the theme of the play, and the technique of the play, and the prologue of the play, and the Bharatavakya of the play, and so on. The Lord has been also portrayed as an artist, as a Chitrakara. In Vakrokti Jivita, we get this beautiful statement. Jagat Tritaya Vaichitriya Chitra Karma Vidhayinam Shivam Shakti Parispanda Matro Upakaranam Numaha. So for an artist to draw a picture, he requires various Upakaranas. But on the other hand, Lord Shiva is a special artist who has only the Shakti Parispanda as his Upakarana. And yet he is able to create such variety, Jagat Tritaya Vaichitriya Chitra Karma Vidhayinam. And we have in, for example, the Chintamani Stotra, it says, Nirupadana Sambharam Abhitta Vivatanvate Jagat Chitram Namastasmai Kalashlaghya Yashuline. Lord Shiva draws this picture of the world, Jagat Chitram. And the irony or the wonder is that there are no upakaranas there. Nirupadana sambharam. There are no upadanas and there are no sambharas. There are no samagri there. And abhitta vevatanvate. And there is no canvas to paint upon. So such is the wondrous creation of this world. The Lord being described as a poet, so he is famous in this Stavachintamani. So it says, Namastrailokya Nirmana Kavaye Shambhave Yataha Pratikshanam Jagannatya Rasiko Prayoga Rasiko Janaha. It says that Lord Shiva is the Kavi because it is he who has built this three worlds. So he has created the three worlds. Namastrailokya Nirmana Kavaye Shambhave Yataha. And this Jagannatya is being witnessed by everyone. Pratikshanam Jagannatya Prayoga Rasiko Janaha. And in Katha Sarit Sagara, so it's not merely in Alankarika works. So even in just sotras and literature, we find these descriptions. In Katha Sarit Sagara, he says, Aragam api ragadhya rachana chaturam param haram navanamascharya sarga chitrakaram numaha. So the Lord is the greatest artist. So the Srishti itself is the Chitra, and the Lord himself, Araga, he has transcended Raga and Dvesha, but yet the creation is full of Raga. Ragadhya, Rachana, Chaturam, Param, Haram, Navanavascharya, Sarga, Chitrakaram, Numaha. So we bow down to him. So the Lord in sum is the source and the origin of all the various types of arts. So that's why the Vayu Purana calls him Sarvashilpa Pravartakaha and Namo Nartana Shilaya and so on. The Lord is also known as the dancer. So in the Mahabharata, in the Shiva Sahasranama, we get this expression of Shiva. Nritya Priyaha, Nitya Nartaha, Nartakaha, Sarvalalasaha, Sarvaturya Vinodicha, Ninadicha, Sarvatodya Parigraha. So thus the master, he is the person who is a supreme dancer, Nartakaha. We know that Lord Shiva is known as the Nataraja. And during his dance, the Pradosha Samaya, there is a beautiful musical concert with the involvement of all the divinities. There is a beautiful shloka which shows the participation of the various divinities. Vagdevi Dhritaval. Priyoganvita Vishnu Sandra Madanga Vadana Patahu Deva Samanta Sthitaha Sevante Tamanu Pradosha Samaye Devam Radani Patim. So Vagdevi is playing on the lute, on the Veena, Vagdevi Dhritamal Vallaki, and Indra plays on the flute, Shatamakho plays on the mridanga, Vishnu Sandra mridanga vadana patuhu, and all the divinities are assembled there. Deva samanta sitaha sevante tamanu pradosha samaye devam mridani patim. So Lord Vishnu himself is shown as a person who puts on, he is an actor. So Vedanta Deshika says, devona shubhamatanotu dashadha nirvartayan bhumikam. He puts on 10 roles. So dashadha nirvartayan bhumikam, and Lakshmi herself acts accordingly. Yadharma iriha dharmani viharate nanakritir naika. Elsewhere, Vedanta Deshika himself says, Shailushavad vividha vesha parigraham tvam. Like a Shailusha, like an actor, you come with various veshas, so in various garments and dresses and appearances. In the Vishnu Sahasranama, it has been very clearly stated that yoga jnanam tadha sankhyam vidya shilpa adikarmacha veda shastrana vijnanam etat sarvam janardanat. All the kalas originate from the Lord himself. In the Bhagavata, Lord Krishna's dance is described in terms of akhila kaladi guru nanartha. So he is the adiguru of all the kalas. So such is the intimate association with all the divinities in our tradition. And for Lord Shiva, it is said that for his dance, the entire world is his stage. Jagatrayam Shambhava Nartanasthali. So all the three worlds constitute the Nartanasthali or the stage for the dance of Shiva. And Lord Shiva himself is referred to as importing all the 64 kalas to Garga. So Chatushashtyangam Adadat Kalajnanam Mamadbhutam. So these 64 kalas were imparted by Lord Shiva. And Thus, we find that all our devas and devis so are intimately associated with music and dance. For example, Devi is referred to as Jaya Sangeeta Rasike and Kuchanchita Vipanchikam. And in Saundarya Lahari, we have Vipanchya Gayanti Vividham Apadanam Pashupatehe and so on. Thus, we find that the Lord himself is viewed as embodying the various varied branches of art. And we see in the Sahitya Darpana of Vishwanatha, so he says that the kind of joy that we get in poetry is something that has no parallel. So he says, Sattvodreka dakhandasva prakashananda chinmayaha vedyantara sparshashunyo brahmaswata sahodaraha lokottara chamatkara pranaha kaishchit pramatribhihi swakara vadabhinnatvena ayam aswadyate rasa. It's only a few pramatris who can enjoy the beauty of this art of poetry wherein a person is totally oblivious of vedyantara. So Vigalita Vedyantaram, so as Mamata himself says, and thus the enjoyment and the enjoyer and the enjoyed all coalesce into one, comparable to the Tripitikshaya that we come across in the yogic experience. And this happens when there is a Sattvodreka. So in the writings of Bhattanayaka and Bhattatauta, etc., the philosophical depths are very well explained, into the details of which I cannot go into. And therefore, this has been styled Brahmaswada Sahodara. The very opening of Chandogya Upanishad is with the reference to the singing of the sun even as he rises. So, the word swar there refers to the singing of the sun, and it is pranava that he sings, it says. And it says, the essence of man is in his speech, purushasya vagrasaha, vachaha rugrasaha, and even the essence of that, the quintessence of that is ruk, the Rigveda, and richaha sama, so it is the sama which is the rasa of even the ruk, and samna udgithaha, and even of saman, it is udgitha, and this udgitha is an extraordinary type of singing, and this we find that it is referred to, that Udgita is referred to as Sa Esha Rasanam Rasatamaha. It is the greatest rasa among the rasas. And thus we find that there is a smooth transition from Shabda Brahma to Nada Brahma to Parabrahma. This is the kind of elevation that our poetical works provide and lead us. So sometimes our poeticians have tried to say that the rasa that we get from poetry is something that can surpass even the rasa that we get from yoga. So says for example Bhattanayaka, who says that this Kalananda is greater than Yogananda. He says, Vagdhenur Dugdha Ekam Hi Rasam Yad Bala Trishnaya Tena Nasya Samasasya Duhyate Yogi Bhirihiyaha. The yogins are known to derive the immense pleasure called Brahmananda. But what this Vagdhenu can do is something that can surpass that. So in Vakrokti Jivita, we get this statement, Chaturvarga Phalas Vadam Apyatikramitad Vidam Kavyamrata Rasena Antashchamatkaro Vithanyate. The Antashchamatkara that one obtains from the Kavya Swada, so is something that transcends the Chaturvarga Phalaswada. There are statements of Mahima Bhatta also to that effect, and as very well stated by Ganesh, it is in this context that Hiriyana also refers to Kavya as the layman's yoga. And incidentally, I must point out that this metaphor of walk as Dhenu is something that goes back to the Vedas themselves. So in the Rig Veda, we have Dhenur Vagasman Upasushtutaitu. And in the Upanishad, we have Vacham Dhenu Upasita. And now this statement of Bhattanayaka also refers to Vag Dhenu. So Dugdham Ekam Hi Rasam Yad so dugdhe rasam. So this vagdhenu rasam dugdhe, it yields such milk that is something no parallel. And that is why Rajashekhara says that the Veda is an extraordinary literature, and he says it is upon contemplation of this Vedic that the various rishis and the Shastrakaras and the poets, they derive howsoever much they can. So, yavan artha udapane. So one should say, namostu tasyai shrutaye yam dhyayanti pade pade rishayaha shastrakarascha kavayascha yathamati. So the limit is only their own intellect, but otherwise there is almost, it is an ocean of ideas and good feelings that one can depend upon and indeed portray in his work. But all the same, you must note the caution given by the greatest of Alankarikas, namely Anandavardhana. He says, he is a master of the shastras, the shastra drishti he has, because it is something that goes into the very depths of the truth of things. Parinishthitartha vishayon mesha. And then, vyaparavati rasan rasayitum kachit kavinam nava. So, the kavi is rasan rasayitum. And both of them, we have described the world through the Shastra Marga and through the Kavya Marga. So, Devratmani, Giro Devyaha, Shastrancha, Kavikarmacha. So, in both of these, he excels. And Shanta Naivacha Labdham Abdhishtayana. Kavyas and Shastras, we may get tired, but never do we get tired. Abdhishtayana, O Lord Vishnu. None of these equals to the sukha that obtains from your bhakti. Tad bhakti tulyam sukham. He says, sakala pramana, it's a very long passage. I read only a very small portion of that. Sakala pramana parinishchita drishta drishta vishi visheshadam yit sukham. That is, by writing in a excellent Shastra, one gets a kind of a joy. And idapi va lokottara excellent kavyas tata ubhayatopi, so surpassing both of them, parameshwara vishranti anandah prakrishyate. So getting vishranti in the Lord is something that excels all these. And he says golden words, tadananda vipran matra vabhaso hi rasaswadaha. The kavi rasaswada that we get is something which is only a vipran matra. So it's only like a small drop of the brahmic bliss that we get. So that we get in the various kavyas and shilpas that we get. So, and it's not even vipran matra avabhasa. So it's only an appearance of the vipran matra of the brahmananda. So, this, there is an intimate relationship between the Brahmaswada and the Kavyaswada, and that is why it has been called Brahmaswada Sahodaraha. And there is a beautiful reference to the Rasa as the Supreme Lord, Raso Vaisaha, in the talk given by Mr. Vinod Vidvams. He elucidated the concept very well, though it requires a small correction. So, It shows how, in fact, there is a play on words there that must also not be missed. So it says, Swakrita is Sukrita. So the creation by the Lord is something that made him feel full of joy. So how grand is this creation. So that is the context in Taittiriya Upanishad, and it's only the asato va sadajayata. So it's there that he, and then when he saw that he himself saw that it was an extraordinary creation and it is a very well done creation. So swakrita, so atmanam swayam akruta, so it made himself. So the Lord has made himself the world, and he saw that it was excellent. So it was therefore sukrita. In fact, in the Bhagavata, we get a reference to how the Lord was in a way not satisfied that it was that he met his greatest joy. But otherwise, the entire creation as a projection of the Lord himself is something extraordinary. And therefore, it is to that raso vai saha is truly applicable. And it is only in the case of the Lord that it becomes a true and a full sukrita in its fullest significance. And it is there that a true rasa is there and all others. So it's only a rasa chaya. So all poets that they can do is only get the chaya of the rasa. So there is a reflection of that original rasa, and we should not equate ourselves with the kind of rasa that the Supreme Lord is and the kind of rasa that the Supreme Lord enjoys, so upon his own creation. So it is against that context that you must note the grandeur of the concept of rasa. Rasagam hevayam labdhva anandi bhavati. I think I have taken a full duration of an hour. So I must conclude with only one note from the Atharva Veda. It says, rasena triptaha nakinchidunaha. So it says, so the person who is satisfied with the rasa, so he would find there is nothing lacking. So for us to lead a full life, so we should become a rasamaya jivana. And it is only through the pursuit of these various arts. So it's only in our tradition that we have this concept of whether it is Gita or Vadya or Nritta. So Yajna, so Nrittam, Gitam, Tatha, Vadyam, Dattva, Devaya, Vishnave, Sarvakama Samriddhasya, Yajnasya Phalamashnute, says Vishnu Dharmottara Purana. And therefore, whether it is Nritta or Gita or Vadya, so playing on these, one becomes, say, one attains the fruit of the performance of full-fledged Yajna. So, and it's only in our civilization that we derive our source to Ananda. So, Ananda Deva Kalyumani Bhutani Jayante, Anandena Jatani Jivanti, Anandena Prayanti, Abhisam Vishanti. And to say that we are all born sinners, that we carry an original sin with us, merely being born, so it is something trivial. So the very antithesis of that is to say that our original sarupa is Sachidananda, and this is the good news that we have to spread to the world. And it is something that is required today for ourselves, for the Hindus who have forgotten their own roots. And therefore, it is only proper that a conference like this is organized, wherein we not only dispel the wrong notions spread regarding our own heritage by the prejudiced and biased Westerners, but on the other hand, there are so many Indians who have been taken in by the ideas of Westerners. The glamour of their economic success and the glamour of their scientific and technological success has blinded us to the very many merits of our own heritage. And it is such conferences as these that serve as excellent reminders to and give a clarion call for us to live up to and enliven our own heritage, the great values of our heritage. I should conclude with a beautiful verse which gives four definitions. So, what is a good knight, Yamini? So who is a good woman, Kamini, and then what is sweet real sweetness, Madhuri, and what is real skill, Chaturi. So all these four are beautifully defined in this verse. Yar akasha shobhana gata ghana sa yamini yamini. That is a beautiful night where it is the full moon and no clouds see disturbing the scenery. Yar akasha shobhana gata ghana sa yamini yamini. Ya saundarya gunanvita patirata sa kamini kamini. It is such a woman who can be said to be the most charming woman. So who not only is endowed with physical beauty, ya saundarya gunanvita, but is also the beauty of the person, the inner beauty, patirata sa kamini kamini. And then ya govinda rasa pramoda madhura sa madhuri madhuri. That madhuriya is a real madhuriya, wherein ya govinda madhuri madhuri. And real skill lies not in merely outwitting others and going and destroying other characters to their own faith and so on. Ya lokad able to achieve the welfare in this world and welfare in the next. So that constitutes real chaturiya. And the common aim of every single type of art in our heritage was directed to
శ్రీనివాస్ గారు కోటి గారు ఆయన్ని అన్మ్యూట్ చేయాలి చూడండి. హలో
యా ఐ మే ఆడిబుల్ నౌ?
ఎస్ 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 యు ఆర్.
ఎస్ ప్లీజ్ సార్. Yeah, I have just concluded.
Thank you very much, Professor Kannan. It was such an erudite and rich address, valedictory address. Thank you very much. Our audience are lucky to have traveled through the entire ocean of aesthetic concepts filled with Hindu metaphysical ideas. Usually there are no questions taken for valedictory address, and I think there are no questions also. Now, after thanking Professor Kannan for this brilliant and scintillating address,